This monster is a Micropolis 1558 drive. At a 5.25-inch full height form factor, this drive brings you 338 megabytes. And I do have the Adaptec ESDI controller to go along with it, so let's see if this beast is still working. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. So while I was exploring the Silicon Graphics SCSI floppy drive and the Quantum Bigfoot ID hard drive in my previous episode, I finally gave it a shot with this Micropolis ESDI hard drive. Micropolis began their life as a manufacturer of floppy drives and controllers, later also producing SCSI and ESDI hard drives. Founded in 1976, the company went into bankruptcy in 1997 and thus shared similar fate to many other drive manufacturing companies who went out of business during the 90s period of market consolidation. Although today you can visit again micropolis.com, the company behind this Micropolis came behind Duisburg, Germany, who sees itself as a modern reincarnation to Micropolis, though with a focus bias towards data migration and preservation aspects. And while their current product line doesn't include any hard drives, their website provides some technical information on the past Micropolis hard drives, like the 1551 that I have. However, there's alternative online resources which provide a lot more details on that ancient hard drive. And as mentioned, this is an ESDI hard drive. ESDI stands for Enhanced Small Disk Interface and was designed by Maxstar in 1983. And while ESDI went ahead to also support removable devices by extending the protocol, it also greatly increased on the throughput, reaching as high as 20 megabit per second, whereas the much earlier SD506 by Sugar Technologies topped at 7.5 megabit per second. Still, ESDI used the same cabling style than the SD506, consisting of one dedicated data cable per drive and one daisy-chain control cable. Don't be fooled by the control cable, it's 34 pins like the floppy drive cable and has as well a twist, but look closely, that is not the same as the one found on the floppy drive cable. And don't mix them up or your driver controller is toast. Now, ESDI drives also have a device ID which is set by jumpers. If you use the controller cable without a twist, you'd be required to set a non-conflicting device address. However, for a controller supporting two devices per port, the use of a twisted cable comes in handy. As much as it exists for the same reason on the original floppy drive in the IBM PC, the twist inverses the drive select pins. This has the benefit that you don't need to bother to set the device address, but you can just set it to address 2 for both hard drives on the same control wire as suggested by the manual. The twist will inverse it, which will result in 2 unique device addresses. The only thing you must pay attention to is this one. This is a removable line terminator. The last drive on the ESDI bus must be terminated to reduce signal interference. As noted, the first or primary drive always connects to the end of the wire. Whether it is the only drive on the bus or not, it must have the terminator installed. Is the second drive connected, which goes to the middle post of the cable, the terminator on that drive must be removed. As for the controller, I have here the Adaptec ACB-2322B, which is both an ESDI and a floppy drive controller. Now, I was misled when I read the user's guide first, as it stated to fit XT and AT height machines. So I was like, yeah, I'll fit it into this XT, just to see if it works. But nah, the XT5160 has only 8-bit ISA slots, whereas the manual also states you need to equip it into a 16-bit ISA slot. That makes sense. It was obviously meant to go with the IBM XT286, 5162, which did have 16-bit slots. So no luck here.
Now, while it's open, you could fit that network card already, don't you?
Next time. So I was trying my luck with this Pentium generation Asus mainboard. But even so, I disabled the onboard IDE and floppy drive controllers. I couldn't get the thing to boot. Eventually, I reconfigured the Adaptec controller to use different IRQ and DMA settings for the floppy controller so it wouldn't conflict with the onboard floppy controller. After enabling again the onboard controller, I could at least boot from the floppy. Following the instruction guide, one should configure a Type 1 hard drive in the BIOS. One would then boot from a floppy, run the debug command and invoke the Adaptec config utility by calling the C800:5 function. And it appeared, though stating it wouldn't find a hard drive. And no matter what I tried to configure the drive in the BIOS, I couldn't get any progress with that old card equipped to the Asus mainboard. It's probably just too modern. The Adaptec ACB-2322B was clearly made for an AT-style mainboard. Now, I don't have a PCAT, and the oldest machine I have that can absorb this card is this high-screen 386 machine. You've been seeing this one in my earlier episode for installing Windows 95. This mainboard, as opposed to the Asus mainboard, doesn't have integrated controllers yet, but uses add-in boards for connecting the drives, much like the original PC, XT and AT systems. So I'll unplug the disk controller and fit the Adaptec card instead. The good thing is, as expected, the system booted from the floppy drive connected to the ACB-2322B right away. So at least that works. And to prove it furtherly works, I first tried with not configuring the hard drive in the BIOS, yielding again the same message about not having a hard drive connected. Then I went to configure a Type 1 drive, again as the manual implied. So I clearly had the drive spinning up before, this time over I had a different audible result, even so it doesn't really sound healthy. Then again invoking the C800:5 function from debug.com brings up the Adaptec configuration tool. And this time it's not complaining but offering me to format the drive. The procedure is straightforward, as explained in the manual. However, as you see here, the drive seems to have some physical defect, as I only get errors about bad sectors. And to make matters worse, there's this sudden odor of burned electronics in the air. I was quick enough to capture this with my phone. Too bad, as not exactly what I had wished for. I had hoped to use this one as a potential spare drive for an IBM AT should I ever come by an affordable unit. So no happy ending for today. I may track down the electronics, it's probably just a blown capacitor, but I suspect this drive endured some shock and potential head crash. And there won't be magic tricks to recover from such a condition. What do you think about it? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again next Sunday.